Hello, we are the Groots, and our group consists of Ariana Ramirez, Ashley Rubio, Juliana Arona, and our mentor, Anne Breck. We created an investigation based on a mysterious green patch at our research site. This presentation will be about the mysterious green patch we found and the effects of soil characteristics on plant diversity in Long Valley.
So for our site, we decided to choose a very interesting site that had caught the eye of our watch teacher and then ours. We were intrigued by the fact that there was a random green patch in the middle of some very dry looking plants. We thought to ourselves, what could be causing this mysterious green patch? Before we even went onto the site, we looked at many aerial images of the patch over the years. When we got there, we noticed that there was a sort of divide in between the green patch and the trail we walked through to get to our site. With help from mentors and teachers, we decided to split up our site into three different zones. Zone A, which was where the green patch was located, Zone B, where there was a sort of mix of dry hardin grass and green grass, and Zone C, where we saw almost nothing else but dry hardin grass. Not long after, we discovered that what we were looking at was none other than an alluvial fan. We decided to take a good look at this alluvial fan through aerial images, and we discovered that it was changing quite often. We captured some aerial images of this site where our alluvial fan formed from 2009 up until recent years in 2018. Just look at the differences from the surrounding area to the green patch itself. Also included is a diagram that shows how all alluvial fans are formed. The testable question we came up with for our mysterious green patch was, how do soil characteristics affect plant abundance and diversity in Long Valley? The reason we were wondering why or how the soil characteristics affected the plants in our site was because we had originally hypothesized that the NPK nutrients in the soil was what caused the drastic differences in the diversity of plants in each zone. Although this was our first thought, we later discovered that the differences were most likely caused by the formation of the alluvial fan itself. In case you didn't know, alluvial fans are the result of erosion events which deposit sediment and other particles into a fan shape, happening around valley-like areas similar to ours. The NPK nutrients mentioned before are what the soil testing kit provided to us asked us to do, which was testing the nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium of the soil samples we took. The abundance and diversity of the plants we saw are two different things we looked at. The abundance was the total number of plants, and the diversity was how many species of plants there were in our zones. The materials we used during our field days and some even after were things we really couldn't have gone without. For example, in the field where our green patch was located, we used the auger PVC pipes, the transect, the quadrats, and the meter stick. In the classroom with our samples of soil, we used the Lamott soil testing kit to determine the amount of NPK nutrients in the soils we had. As we can see in the far top right picture, it shows how it would give us the amount of nutrients depending on what color the soil would turn. We decided that what was going to take us the largest amount of time was measuring the nutrients of the soil samples we took and characterizing our soils, so we got to doing that first. We started off by setting up the transect of 60 feet going from zone A, where the green patch was, through zone B, where there were mixed grasses, up until zone C, where it was mostly just very dry grasses. We then chose three spots, one in each zone, and used the auger to dig a 60 centimeter hole, taking samples at 10, 30, and 60 centimeters deep within the hole using the meter stick. We took soil samples from NPK tests to do in class and laid the rest of the soil that we collected on a PVC pipe so we could use the globe characterization protocol to analyze the soil profiles in site A and site C. Unfortunately, we did not have enough time to characterize the soils in zone B. On class days that we did not get to visit our green patch, we would use our samples collected at the site to test the nutrients of each soil from each zone. The color sheets that came in the kit gave us a variety of colors with a number or a range of high, medium, or low that would tell us the amount of nutrients the soils had. Although for the plants, it was not such a long process. First, we set up a transect starting from zone A, which was around the edge of the green patch, going all the way to where there was almost nothing but dry grass, which was mostly dry hardin grass in zone C. We set this transect up parallel to the one we used for augering up samples of the soils, but we put it 5 feet apart. We did it so that the plants we tasted wouldn't be affected, since in order to take the soil samples, we had to step on some of the plants that were there. After putting this transect parallel to where we dug the hole, we put down three quadrats so we could record and observe the abundance and diversity of the plants inside each of the quadrats we put down. With this, we made our pie charts of the general abundance and diversity of each zone.
Here you can see that Zone A, otherwise known as our mysterious green patch, had the highest species richness, followed by Zone B and then Zone C. Below each graph, you can see the most abundant species in each zone. Some of the species we were able to identify included willow, which was species 6, Harding grass, which was species 1, mustard, which was species 4, and clustered tarweed, which was species 7. Depicted above is the nutrient and pH data for the sites at 10, 30, and 60 centimeters before and after rainfall. You can use the conversion table below to see what each level of nitrogen, phosphorus, or potassium means. Something interesting we noticed is how phosphorus levels increased after the rain while pH levels and other nutrients stayed relatively the same. It's important to know that the soil pH of zone A lowered the deeper we dug. The most revealing piece of data we discovered was that nutrient levels were not indicative of how green each zone was. The graph on the left shows us that after a period of no rainfall in 2016, there was a lot more rain beginning in January of 2017, with the highest spike of precipitation happening on February 20th, 2017. The graph on the right gives us a closer look at what was happening on the week of February 14th through February 24th of 2017. Consequently, the soil was becoming saturated and the water table was rising, making an alluvial fan more likely to happen. As mentioned earlier, we characterized the soil in only two of our sites, which were Zone A and Zone C. We found that on top of being visually different, the structure, consistency, and texture of soils in both zones greatly differ. The soil color swatches and comparisons of the horizons show us that after the third horizon of Zone A, it begins to look like Zone C starting from its first horizon. The top three horizons of Zone A also indicate a different soil that was almost certainly caused by erosion. Because of this project, we learned that just because an area might be greener, like Zone A, doesn't necessarily mean that it has a higher amount of nutrients. We concluded that the alluvial fan had the highest probability of forming on February 20th of 2017, because all of our data pointed towards this date. And because there was a dry spell in the fall of 2016 leading up to the alluvial fan formation, the heavy rainfall that formed our alluvial fan could be associated with climate change. Alluvial fans have been known to cause changes in vegetation after they deposit different sediments, similarly to what happened in our project's site. We believe this is what caused the green spot, as we call it.
Some questions we were left with and wondered if others were thinking too were questions like, is climate change responsible for erosion events such as an alluvial fan formation? How do new alluvial fan formations affect the animals and other plants that depend on this land to survive? Do alluvial fans force anything or any animal to adapt to a change in environment? Maybe if we had more time out in the field, we could have answered or partially answered some of these questions. We most likely would have identified most or all of the plant species and maybe looked to see if we could find another alluvial fan so we could compare and contrast both of them. This way we would be able to notice any trends in vegetation or nutrients, if any. What we could have done could also be good suggestions for future projects. There are also many other interesting future project ideas that could be done surrounding any alluvial fan. For example, it would be interesting to record and observe other subjects in the alluvial fans, like the animals and or insects around and in the alluvial fan, done by setting up pitfall traps in each zone to see the abundance and diversity of the insects. Or we could also observe how one alluvial fan could affect a whole ecosystem, which would take a lot of time, but who knows, maybe it'll be worth it.
Our project might be important to organizations like California's Department of Fish and Wildlife, amongst any other organizations/agencies interested in plant or habitat restorations that need to know how alluvial fans might affect vegetation or soil of an area. Elkhorn Slough National Estuarine Research Reserve might also be interested in the information we produced because they could try to look deeper into the effects of alluvial fans, like how they affect Elkhorn Slough either positively or negatively.
What we enjoyed from our unique site. There was many things we enjoyed about our site, but what we enjoyed the most was the amount of diversity there was within our location and also how different our location was in comparison to other groups. Our location is a diverse place not only in plants but in soils as well. Furthermore, there was unique aspects of the location that made it special to us. Our site was an alluvial fan that was the base of our project since it was what we based our conclusions on. It was used to determine why the plant diversity was caused along the differences in soil. It was a site that was isolated from other groups and that changed various times throughout the years.
On behalf of the Groots, we would like to thank the following people and organizations for their contributions slash help with our project. We wouldn't have been able to do this without them. Ann and Willem Brack, science mentors, the Monterey Bay Aquarium and their staff, Martha Arciniega, Kim Swan, Enrique Melgoza, Kenton Parker, Monica Morales, Alyssa Wante, Justin Lane, George Matsumoto, and Steve Haddock. Esner and their staff, Peggy and Bruni Mora.
Here we have a video of the whole presentation explained in Spanish. Ahora les mostraremos un video que describe toda la presentación, pero en español. Hola, nosotras somos los Groots y este equipo consiste de Ariana Ramírez, Ashley Rubio, Juliana Rona y Amber Arc, nuestra mentora. Nosotras creamos una investigación basada en un parche verde. Esta presentación será sobre el misterioso parche verde, efectos de las características de la Tierra sobre la diversidad vegetal en Long Valley. La introducción. Para comenzar, les estaré definiendo algunas palabras que si no entienden ahora, ojalá las puedan entender mejor después de mi explicación, y ya que son palabras muy importantes para entender este proyecto. Algunas de las palabras son un abanico aluvial, el cual es un resultado de una erosión. Lo que pasa aquí es que se depositan sedimentos y otras partículas en la figura de un abanico, cuales típicamente ocurren alrededor de áreas con valles. El NPK son nitratos, fosfatos y potasios, los cuales son nutrientes. El pH es una medida de qué tan acídico o básico es algo. La abundancia es la cantidad de algo, y la diversidad es cuando varias cosas son diferentes o tienen diferentes características o cualidades. Nuestra pregunta de investigación para nuestro proyecto fue: ¿cómo afectan las características de la tierra a la abundancia y diversidad de las plantas en Long Valley? Nuestra hipótesis para esta pregunta fue que nosotras hipotetizamos que este cambio en la vegetación fue causado por una mayor concentración de nutrientes de NPK más cerca del parche verde. Aquí podemos ver el mapa del sitio. A la mano izquierda podemos ver las tres zonas en donde hicimos nuestra investigación, las cuales fueron zona A, B y C. Y en la siguiente imagen, que es hacia la mano derecha, podemos ver las imágenes aéreas de nuestro sitio antes y después del abanico aluvial. Aquí podemos ver los materiales utilizados como una barrena, un transexto, un tubo de PVC y un arreglo de metros, por nombrar algunos. El protocolo. Básicamente nuestro protocolo era diferente cada día, pero en resumen lo que hicimos es que pusimos un transecto a 60 pies del abanico aluvial, el cual es el parche verde. Después marcamos el parche verde como zona A y a 60 pies marcamos como zona C. En medio de ambas zonas pusimos a la zona B, la cual era una mezcla de ambos. Después utilizamos la barrena para sacar tierra de ambos lugares para hacer las pruebas de NPK y de pH, al igual que para hacer las características de la tierra, las cuales solo fueron hechas en zona A y C. Después, en las tres zonas utilizamos el cuadrante para ver la diversidad y abundancia de la vegetación. Aquí podemos ver los datos de la vegetación y podemos ver que la zona A fue la que tuvo la mayor diversidad de vegetación, seguida por la zona B y después por la zona C. Debajo de cada gráfica podemos ver la planta que tuvo más abundancia en cada zona. Algunas de las especies que vimos fueron willow y harding grass, etc. Aquí podemos ver los datos de los nutrientes y pH. Podemos ver los nutrientes y pH en 10, 30 y 60 centímetros en cada zona, después y antes y después de las lluvias. También pueden utilizar la tabla de conversión para ver qué significa cada nivel de nitratos y fosfatos y potasio. Algo interesante que notamos fue que los niveles de fosfato incrementaron después de la lluvia, mientras que el pH y los otros nutrientes se quedaron relativamente en el mismo nivel. Lo que sí pudimos observar es que los nutrientes en las tres zonas fueron relativamente similares. Aquí podemos ver los datos de la lluvia. La gráfica de la lluvia hacia la izquierda demuestra el periodo de tiempo en el cual no llovió durante el 2016. Después se puede observar que hubo mucha lluvia al comienzo del 2017, con la mayor lluvia cantidad en el 20 de febrero del 2017. La gráfica hacia las derechas nos demuestra la semana del 20 de febrero. Consecuentemente, la tierra se puso más saturada y la cantidad de agua incrementa, causando la probabilidad de que se haya creado un abanico aluvial. Aquí podemos observar los datos de la caracterización de la Tierra. Como mencionamos anteriormente, nosotras caracterizamos la Tierra de dos sitios, zona A y C. Lo que nosotras encontramos al hacer esto fue que no solo eran visualmente diferentes estas zonas, sino que también eran diferentes en estructura, consistencia y textura, lo que causó una gran diferencia entre ambas zonas. La comparación de ambos horizontes nos demuestra que después del tercer horizonte de la zona A se comienza a ver el principio de la zona C. Los primeros tres horizontes de zona A comienzan a indicar una tierra diferente que definitivamente fue causado por una erosión. Discusión, ¿qué aprendimos y por qué es importante? Por este proyecto pudimos aprender que solo porque un área se mira más verde como la zona A no significa que hayan más nutrientes que en otro lugar menos verde. Nosotras concluimos que el abanico aluvial probablemente fue creado el 20 de febrero del 2017 porque todos nuestros datos nos dirigen hacia esa fecha. Porque hubo un tiempo de sequía en el otoño del 2016, el cual era antes de que se creara el abanico aluvial, la gran cantidad de lluvia que cayó después ese invierno causó que se formara el abanico aluvial, el cual puede estar asociado con el cambio climático. Los abanicos aluviales son conocidos por cambiar la vegetación después de que depositan diferentes sedimentos, similarmente a lo que ocurrió en nuestro sitio. Nosotras creemos que esto fue lo que causó el misterioso parche verde. Ideas de proyectos para el futuro y posibles preguntas. Algunas preguntas que nos terminó dejando este proyecto fueron: ¿cuál es la conexión entre los abanicos aluviales y el cambio climático? ¿Causan adaptación los abanicos aluviales? Estas solo son algunas preguntas de que se crearon en nuestras mentes. Algunos proyectos para el futuro serían identificar todas las especies de vegetación, observar y apuntar animales como insectos en cada zona, notando la diversidad y abundancia, y observar animales más grandes dentro o alrededor del abanico aluvial, solo por nombrar algunas cosas que se podrían hacer. Posibles patrocinadores. Algunos posibles patrocinadores para nuestro proyecto podrían ser como el Departamento de Pesca y Vida Silvestre de California, al igual que a cualquier otra organización que esté interesada en la restauración de plantas o hábitats que tal vez ocupan saber cómo un abanico afecta la vegetación o tierra del área. Otros patrocinadores podrían ser Ocean Stream National Estuarine Research Reserve, al igual que varias agencias que estén buscando en un lugar donde crear un estanque en Ocean Stream. Lo que disfrutamos de nuestro único sitio. Hubieron varias cosas que disfrutamos de nuestro sitio, pero lo que disfrutamos más fue cuánta diversidad había en esta locación y qué tan diferente era en comparación a otros grupos. Nuestro sitio no solo era diverso en vegetación, pero en tierra también. Este sitio que escogimos estaba aislado de los demás grupos y tenía un ambiente de paz. Es un sitio que se destaca de los demás y varias personas de Eisner están tratando de proteger. Algunos aspectos únicos de nuestro sitio fue que era un abanico aluvial y que no estuvimos ahí cuando se construyó. Esas son solo unas cosas que son únicas de nuestro sitio. Para concluir, quisiéramos expresar nuestra gratitud hacia personas como nuestros mentores de ciencia, Ann y William Brack, el personal de Watch como Marta Arciniega, Enrique Melgoza, Kim Swamp, Kenton Parker, Mónica Morales, Alisa Guante, Justin Lane, George Mastunmoto y Steve Haddock. Otras personas serían también como el personal de Eisner, como Peggy Folletta y Bernie Mora. Muchas gracias por su atención y espero que les haya gustado nuestro proyecto.